Greetings, and I am Charmel McMillan, and this is the 20th episode of Just One Thing, my show that talks about life-changing, life-defining moments, highlighting some amazing people from all over the world who have been pushed closer to their purpose, closer to their destiny, and tonight will be no different. This show is based on my best-selling book, Just One Thing, Foreword by Mike Epps. I'm a firm believer that destiny is when the unexpected meets the inevitable. And so I am so excited about my guest tonight. She is one of the most beautiful, most intriguing women I've been blessed to meet in my 26-year career. And I thoroughly enjoyed meeting and speaking with her the other night. She has a stellar career. You're going to hear all about it. But not only was she the last member of the Supreme signed to Motown, she also toured with Ray Charles as part of the Raylettes and Stevie Wonder. And she has a 5-octave range. She can blow. So please welcome my very beautiful and special guest, Miss Susaye Greene.
Hello, hello, Char. How are you?
I'm great today. I really am. I've had a long day already, but it's been very exciting.
Can you move just a little bit to the opposite side? I'm trying. So you're centered because you're a little off center. So I want that way. Yes, the way you did.
Yes,
yes, gotcha. Perfect now.
Gotcha.
Yes. So,
thank you.
We talked the other night when I said, "Tell me your life story." It was the most amazing story I've ever heard. So, your story and you have been amazing since the beginning. You came from prodigy parents. So let's talk about your childhood and your parents, and move right into your life defining moments and things that you know fulfilled your purpose and your destiny and what you really desired. Okay, so let's go.
Sure.
Your life and when you were growing up and stuff?
I was born in Houston, Texas. Yes. I was born in Houston, Texas, and my parents were both from Texas. My mother was from a small town called Nacogdoches. And my dad, of course, was from the big city. He was from Houston. They met, as so many young Black kids meet, through their families. Mm-hmm. And they fell in love at 14. So they knew each other from then. Of course, they weren't allowed to date or anything like that. But from what my mother said, she knew that he was her destiny. And as they grew older, they kept in touch. And finally, they married and moved to Houston. And when I was born, of course, I was born in Houston, but I've never lived in Houston. We moved. They went to Denver, Colorado. First, they went to Los Angeles because my mother's sister was there and her brother. But after that, they moved to Denver, Colorado. And that's really, I think, moving to Denver was such a decisive moment in their lives. Because they became two of the first Black DJs in America.
Wow.
There in Denver. Mm-hmm. Denver is has a spot called the Five Points, where the streets all come together. And there was a hotel there called the Rossonian, which was owned by a Black family in Denver. And my mother played the piano in the lounge. But the thing about the Rossonian, because it was so central in the city, they were always getting all the big acts, whoever came through the area went to the Rossonian, either to jam the musicians, you know, or just to meet and greet. My mother became such a big part of the community in Denver. And my older sister, Jade, of course, became ill while we were there in Denver. She was the sixth child in America to be diagnosed with lupus erythematosus. Of course, lupus was not known. I mean, to imagine the sixth child, you know, there was very little known about lupus at the time, except that she needed to have blood transfusions very often. And because they had the radio show and knew people all over America, they were able to get many, many blood donations and money to help support her illness. But Jay died at 12. And that was really a defining moment in my life. I was just a little bitty girl, you know, who had no consciousness really of life and death, other than I'm just going through, you know, my life, living it. But because she passed, and she knew she was going to, you know, she was a very serious little girl. She would sit me down. I called her Jady, and Jade was just very wise, like an old person. And she knew that it was going to be difficult for me. So she sat me down and talked to me, and she says, I'm going to go to heaven. But I want you to know that I will be your angel, always looking over you. And that's a comforting thought, you know, mm-hmm. from a child, from one child to another. Yes. My brother was born at that time, which was difficult, you know, for my mom, losing a child, because that's out of balance with nature. Mm-hmm. You know, right, you're not exactly supposed to go after your kids, you know. Yes. But it gave me a certain kind of bravery, even mm-hmm. though, you know, I'm not fearless, like, you know, I'm not foolish, let me put it that way.
Yes.
But I don't look at death as an ending. Mm-hmm. I look at it as a part of life that is inevitable. And because of that, I think, you know, I was the middle child, but it gave me the opportunity, I think, to come forward, you know, my yes. personality to come yes. forward. And I worked since I was a little bitty kid. I did baby food commercials. And my parents decided at a certain point to separate. You know, mm-hmm. the death of a child is a devastating mm-hmm. event in a family's life. And indeed. they couldn't work it out at the time. So my dad moved to Los Angeles without us. And my mom went on, you know, she had a big choir there that was the Vivian Greene choir. And they had a record shop, you know, okay. a beautiful record shop. I have pictures of it even.
Oh, wow.
But the things that you learn by losing, there's always a gain, you know,
yes.
on another plane, let me put it that way.
Can I ask you this, Susaye? I always believe that when one spirit is released into the heavens, the universe, then it propels strength into the person, maybe even that they love the most. Did you feel her strength as you began to soar, for lack of a better word, and the unimaginable opportunities and things of that? Did you feel her spirit with you all along? Because I really believe that that's God empowering you, you know, so now they're yes. free, and that energy and that strength you talked about, she had at 12, it just seems yes. like it had to be a part of you, become a part of you.
Oh, there's no doubt. There's no doubt. You know, very often I will still dream of her. They're all gone now. My mother, my father, and Jade are gone, and my brother Al, you know. But they are, I truly believe that when your family and loved ones leave you, they become your intercessors, you know. Yes. They are there to speak on your behalf and to kind of nudge, you know, nudge you into doing the right direction and doing the right thing. And I very often, she will still come into my dreams and tell me, you know, you need to, you know,
go for it.
That's right. That's right. You know,
that is beautiful.
So you're never away. You're never really away from them. I love that.
Exactly. So as you said, your father moved to LA, and so what happened with you, and your brother was born by then, so what happened with you all?
Yes. Well, my parents decided to get back together,
okay.
and we moved to LA.
Okay.
Hey, you know, stuff happens. And when you're a child, you know, children see. Yeah, they see everything. Children see everything, but they don't, I think they ignore a lot, you know. Mm-hmm. When you're that small, you know, it's what your family, it's the dynamic that your family has. At any right. rate, we moved back, but of course, Jade was gone, and my mother and brother and I went to Los Angeles, and at a certain point, they decided to go to New York. So that's really where I grew up, was in New York City.
Oh,
I consider myself a New Yorker.
Mm-hmm. Mm. That must have been exciting. So what happened while you were in New York? I know something happened.
Oh, so much. Oh, yeah. So much. You know, I continued to I continued to work. Okay. I started doing commercials. I had a bread commercial. I mean, there was a young lady who was in the same roster as my agent. And okay. We did several. A lady Wait, named Emily.
So how did you get to having an agent?
It was beautiful.
So you told. I believe you told me when we were speaking. Your mom was like a star maker. She was like the ultimate momager, but she was also making and training other stars. And you dropped Absolutely. Some names. So who yeah, was your mom working yeah. with? How did you jump from being a little girl to little having girl, an agent?
To a little girl with an agent, right?
Right.
Well, my mother was an educator. You know, okay. that was her spirit. She was an educator. She was a tremendous musician, mm-hmm. classical pianist of the highest. I mean, she had a master's in music, you know, and she had been the youngest person to ever graduate from Prairie View University. She was 17 when she graduated, which meant when she went into college, she was 13 years old and had wow. to have a chaperone, which must have been a big drag.
Yes.
But you know, she was the child prodigy, you see.
Okay.
So uh-huh. the dean of that school, whose name was O. Anderson Fuller, really he and his wife took her under their wing and helped yeah. to continue her classical training and her she graduated valedictorian at 17. You know, you can't fight these things.
Right.
But because she was an educator at heart, she knew that she could train me properly, and that's how I developed my range. She could listen to you and know what areas you needed strengthening. Mm-hmm. And that's what she did with me. I was horribly shy as a little girl. Wow. And I would, you know, sink back and not talk if I could keep from it. But mm-hmm. she would say, Susaye, pushing me forward, just sing. And that's what I'd do. You know, I was confident in that because I knew I was well trained. I knew what I was doing. And so I had no fear in that area. So when we went to New York, she said, because of this educational mindset, well, let me get you an agent. And that's what she did. She played the piano at a place called Gatsby's, which was right across the street from the UN. And because mm-hmm. of its location, you got a lot of really people who had a lot of money, who had opportunities, tremendous networks. Yeah. And through them, she was able to find private schools for me. I went to mm-hmm. professional children's school where I did my, what they call your shop in the mornings. You did, you know, your training and that, ballet dancers, ice skaters, rock and roll people, you know, a lot of really talented young kids. What was the young girl's name who was married? She was married to Frank Sinatra. And then she married Woody Allen.
Okay.
And
okay.
her name has gone out of my head. She was in Rosemary. Exactly.
Yes. Okay.
Exactly. But her sister, Prudence, was in my class at the professional children's school. And we did a lot of, because my largest class had maybe 8 kids in it. You know,
okay.
you were given the opportunity to really have attention from the teacher. And that made every difference for me. It really did. But all of these kids, there was a group called the McCoys who had a hit called Hang On Sloopy. That was a big hit, and they were going to that school. You know, they were all professional kids.
Yes.
And once I graduated from there, I went to the School of Performing Arts. You had to audition, and I was majoring in drama. I auditioned. There were 5,000 kids that came from all over New York and the country, for that matter, to try to get into the School of Performing Arts. That's the school that Fame, the movie and the TV show, was founded after.
Okay.
So you would go, yeah, just fantastic. I mean, simply fantastic. You were able to study the Stanislavski method in acting, mm-hmm. and you learn to dig deep. You know, you had Suzanne. I mean, so many people that went to that school became successful actors, right. or musicians,
the
or
real
dancers,
grooming,
you know,
of talent. There were
the three. Whoo! Seriously, and because there were so many. Yes, exactly. That's exactly true. But because there were so many kids, you know, and you're auditioning, you had to do two pieces. You had to do a comedy piece, and you had to do something very serious, like Shakespeare. And that's okay. what I chose, was the Romeo and Juliet. You know, it was kind of the one that you did at that age, you know. Yes. Mm-hmm. And I was accepted. And when you were accepted, you knew you were bad, you know. Right. But you were there to become fine at your craft, yes. to hone yes. your craft, and to really dig deep and find your personality. And we weren't allowed to work outside, but of course everyone did during the summers. And mm-hmm. I worked in the Catskill Mountains, which was a huge Jewish community that yes. the wives and kids all would go to the Catskills, and the men would stay in the city because they mm-hmm. were running their businesses, you know. And a lot of them were quite well to do, but they were on every level. So you had these places that you could play maybe three shows a night if mm-hmm. you were really, you know, you could push it. But there was a comedian, mm-hmm. there was a singer, I was a singer, and there was a something like a juggler or a dancer of some kind, you know, and each place had the same setup. Yes. But of course the bigger place, the higher you got up around the mountain, you had Jerry Lewis and Kenny Youngman and all of these tremendous comics, which is where I found my love for comedy. You know, I love comedy and comedians.
And
I
you have a
do.
Great sense of humor. We were cracking up the other night. Okay, so
yes.
let me ask you.
Yes,
this.
We were.
You have clearly been groomed for greatness. What was that life-changing moment where, I think this happened first, where you ended up in Motown, or you connected with Motown? How did that come to be?
Well, you know, I don't think there are any coincidences in life. I've always been very strong in my faith, and I believe that God has put me where he's wanted me to be. I have made no plans. I guess we're doing this. And
yes.
blessedly enough, it's worked out for me. You know, I woke up and I set up actually and said, okay, if I'm going to write songs, I want to write with Stevie Wonder. And my mother, who was really such an unlikely person, you know, she'd look at me and she'd go, yeah, you can do that. You know, she never discouraged me. In fact, right. she encouraged me terribly. She really did. But I called Motown. What can I say? I called, I looked
did
it up,
know
I looked the number
at
up.
Motown, or you just decided I'm gonna call Motown?
I didn't know any. I didn't. I'm calling Motown.
I am with you. That's how
and
my
Stevie Wonder's brother. Okay.
I was like, I'm gonna call
Stevie
call
Wonder's
out.
Brother answered the phone. There you go. Mr. Obama.
Yes.
You know.
You know what, Susaye, I'd say it takes the same amount of faith to dream big as it takes to dream small. You might as well go for
That's
it.
Right. That's exactly how I feel.
Same faith.
That's how I feel. Yeah. Because after all, if you're dreaming, you might as well dream big, you know, yeah. and bigger than your imagination. That's the point to me. Yes. But Stevie Wonder's brother answered the phone. Okay. Now, you know, you can't make this up. I said to him, you know, I would like to meet him and write with him. And he said, well, he's auditioning people right now. And you should come down to this place and audition for him. So next thing I know, I'm on the way. And when I got there, it was a hotel. There's a hotel in Hollywood that's gone now. I'm pretty sure it's gone. But it was like the rock and roll hotel, you know. And Steve had a whole floor and the band Wonder Love was staying there. They were all in different rooms staying there, and out the back window there was a huge ledge that was maybe 10 feet wide, you know, a concrete ledge, and people would come out the window and just go back and forth. You know, everybody knew each other, and I'm there agog. What is this? You know, but I have to say, out of any artist that I've known, and I've known so many, the atmosphere around Stevie Wonder is electric. It's absolutely exciting at all times. You don't know what's going to happen. You don't know who's going to show up. And on top of that, there's all this music. This child can just, he's prolific. And right. I used to take a recorder, a small recorder, and just follow him around. This is once I got the job. But let me back up a little bit about getting the job.
Okay.
He was doing the Grammy show that night, a party at the Century Plaza Hotel. And he said, you know, after he heard me sing, he said, you know, why don't you come to this show? Because everybody's going to be there. And I want you to be in Wonder Love. I want you to be a part of my group. And I want you to have a solo spot in my show. And that's what I did. You know, and I started that night. I came down and I didn't know any of the music. I mean, you know, we all know to hum along, right? The Stevie Wonder songs. But I didn't know the show. So he said, well, you sing, do you know All Is Fair in Love? And I mean, like, thank goodness I did.
Wow.
And he said, okay, he started playing it. And he said, he introduced me. And he said, sing it. And I did. I sang it with him playing the piano. And it was just, it was a magical moment for me, for Stevie Wonder. And, you know, I met so many people. Remember, I had been with Ray Charles when I met Steve. And so, you know, I met so many.
So you were part of the Raylettes first before you went to Motown.
Absolutely.
Okay. There's so much. Although we don't want to leave out the details.
It really is.
Raylettes for almost 5 years, was it? Okay. And then
That's
you met Stevie Wonder. Yeah. And then what
That's
happened?
Well, after that, he started recording. You know, he was doing songs in the key of life. And consequently, I sang Joy Inside My Tears with him as a duet. But Steve and I, you know, there are a few. There's only a couple of people that I know that are that prolific. So I would follow him around with a tape recorder because he's always coming up with ideas, you know. And I'd just record it. And he'd say, you know, did you get it? After a while, he noticed, you know, I'm recording it. Did you get it? Yeah, got it. So at that time, we were using cassettes. Mm-hmm. And he had a bag that had 400 cassettes in it that he left in his car. And someone took it. I'll never forget it. Someone took it. And he was kind of, you know, and we called the police, you know, we said, go on the radio. You know, he went on the radio and he made a call out and said, you know, no questions asked. If you find it, if you know anybody that has it, please bring it back. Do you know they brought it back? They brought it back.
That's a blessing.
You know? And I'm sure he gave them some kind of, oh! I mean, the chances of that happening.
Yes. That's God.
I mean,
because
you.
people don't but, seem as honest as you think, but then something like that happens.
Yeah. It gives you hope. You know, but my life's been full of hope. I cannot deny that. Just yes, it has. It truly has.
Yes.
The way that I, you know, I went from Stevie Wonder to the Supremes. Mm-hmm. You know, I was actually picked up in a car. My mother, once again, my mother was on the Beverly Hills branch of the NAACP. And she and Bob Jones was the head of publicity at Motown, and they were really good friends. He knew that Cindy Birdsong was leaving, and so he asked her to ask if I was interested in being one of the Supremes. And if you knew my mother, you know that she, I mean, when I say she was unlikely, she really was. My mother went to Paris with the children of the head of Gabon, okay, in Africa, because they wanted to sing. They wanted lessons. And they flew her to Paris, put her in a huge, beautiful suite, bought her half of the perfume in Paris. Wow. And then she called me. She called me one night and she said, "Do you know how to cook snake meat?" And I said, "No, like I'm so busy cooking snakes." You know? And she said, "Well," because she had this marvelous sense of things, you know. Mm-hmm. They were, Alain Bongo was the son. He was 16 years old and he wanted to be the African James Brown. He would wear, like, you know, white voluminous silk shirts that looked like, you know, a pirate would wear, very dashing, right. The black leather pants, and you know, she's, and they had their apartment in Paris had its own disco. Mm-hmm. And you know how you have doorknobs that are like gold colored? Well, theirs were real gold. Wow. And they're cooking snake meat in a hotel in England, okay? So she says to me, "What am I gonna do?" I said, "Why? You know, I'm trying to find out, what do you mean?" This is just to show you the types of things, you know, that I was exposed to as a child. She says, "I know they'll want me to taste it, but I don't think I'll be able to." I mean, it was just ridiculous.
That's, you know, hilarious.
But she was such fun. Even now, she will come in my dreams and she'll have funny hats on and things just to make me laugh, you know.
Oh,
so
wow.
I'm still in touch.
That's a blessing. So she was calling you to figure out how she was going to get around eating it, really. Like, they're in here cooking snake meat. I can only imagine.
I'm just thinking, run, you know.
Talking about fried alligator, and so there's so many delicacies you've never thought about eating.
So. But I never would think. I mean, I should imagine that I'd eat a snake if I had to. You know, but that's about it. But she was wonderful. She said to me, you know, "Would you like to be one of the Supremes?" And I said, "Well, it's something I haven't done or considered, so I'm down, you know, I'm game." And the next thing I knew, I'm at one of rehearsal. Uh-huh. As we rehearsed 6 days a week, okay. Mm-hmm. And a long white Mercedes limousine drove up in the parking lot, windows all black. And this car had belonged to George Harrison, one of the Beatles. Mm-hmm. And Mary Wilson had bought the car from him. But here comes this car. I hadn't even met Mary at that time yet. And car opened up. You know, someone opened the door for me. I stepped in and I left Wonderlove, you know. Wow. And Steve was upset with me for a while. But I'm just thinking, you know, I said, like I said to him, "But it's the Supremes." You know, it's something that you must do.
Yes.
And I went into the group. We began rehearsing immediately. They were on the road, actually. When they came home, Mary, I went to Mary's house and met her and met Sherry. Mm-hmm. And a call came in while I was there, and Florence Ballard had passed.
Wow.
And it was very traumatic, a very traumatic time for Mary, because, you know, they'd been kids together. They had been, literally, they had all been kids together. They had gone through so much learning and traveling the world, being exposed to the world, and then having 12 number one records in a row, which no one else had ever done except the Beatles, okay?
Right.
So yes, they broke that record. But when Mary sat down and talked to me, she said, "You know, we have a legacy." And that impressed me, because I know it's true. As a kid, I used to sit and watch them on the Ed Sullivan Show, and I was mm-hmm. so proud, you know, to see yes. these beautiful young black women who were so poised and classy and had such a command of the audience, and people just adored them. But the thing about the Supremes was always, you know, you could be one of them in your mind. You could be Florence, yes, you know, with that heart-shaped face. And she was, you know, sassy. And Mary, who looked like a brown Barbie doll, you know, just beautiful girls. And then big, wide-eyed Diane, you know, who had so much charisma, still does, you know.
Yes.
But I realized that the history was important. I say on stage that when three little girls went to Motown, it was Mary Wilson, Diana Ross, and Florence Ballard. Then Cindy Bird's song came in the group.
Yes.
After that, they became Diana Ross and the Supremes.
Yes.
Then, when Diana left, Jean Terrell came into the Supremes. Mm-hmm. Linda Lawrence came into the Supremes.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Then Sherry Payne replaced Jean Terrell. And finally, I came into the Supremes, and I was the last. And it's something that you can be proud of. Yes, you can be proud of, but beyond that, it makes an impression to young Black girls that anything is possible.
Anything. Because
they came from the Brewster Projects. That's right.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes. That is a beautiful story. And I was just so emotional when we were talking, had a time to talk the other night after meeting a couple of weeks ago, our paths crossing. And one, I'm honored that you came, but I just wanted to make sure that people understood and heard the full story and be a part of at least sharing that, because it's such a huge part of music history. Yes. You've been such a blessing to so many people, so many stages, and your life and the way it has unfolded has been phenomenal. And so did it feel like a full circle moment? Because you mentioned growing up watching some of the icons that you were blessed to end up working with, you know, what did that feel like?
Well, my parents were musicians, obviously. Mm-hmm. And my dad had a huge record collection. Everything. Illinois Jacquet, you know, he loved jazz. Willie the Lion Smith, a lot of obscure things. And then things like Dave Brubeck. Take five. And
there goes the five. Oh,
I was able to see. Oh, yeah. I was able to see the possibilities in music, you know.
Okay.
I wrote songs as a little kid, and I developed it. I give total credit to both Leon Ware, whom I met at Venture Records. And Leon wrote that whole suite of very sexual songs, like Sexual Healing for Marvin Gaye. And Stevie Wonder, you know, they taught me how to write. So I'm forever grateful for that. But when you know that you have talent, I believe you must nurture it, you know. I paint. My mother always provided canvases and paintbrushes and oil paints and watercolors. And I realize in retrospect, you know, she knew where to find me because of that, you know. Because, hey, we're in New York City, you know, anything can happen. I went to school. I grew up in Queens. I went to school. I got on the train. I came out and I was on 57th Street where all the pimps were. And it was a fast world. And I'm just little me, you know, and they holler out their car, hey, little bit and stuff. You know, I turn up my nose and they'd laugh at me because they see me every day. Look at her. Look at her. 4'11 and 3/4. Thank you very much.
3/4 is important. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Because without that.
Miss Susaye, you told me the other, you told me the other night how much of a songwriter you were, but you've talked about it now, but you left out that you co-wrote I Can't Help It with Stevie Wonder for Michael Jackson. You left out that you wrote songs for Denise Williams. You left out half of your discography. So I'm just dropping dropping a couple of names out of all the people you have written hits for. And so besides being, to recap for anyone just joining, besides being a member of the Raylettes with Ray Charles for 5 years, besides being a part of Wonder Love with Stevie Wonder, and then the final member signed to Motown of the Supremes, you are a master songwriter, hit maker, and legendary in that aspect as well. Do you want to speak to that before we talk about what's next?
Sure. Well, first of all, thank you. You know, when you write a song, you're doing it for your own pleasure. And you have no idea how a song will affect other people. But there's something else magic about music, about songs. Because if you think about it, we each have a song that takes us there, takes us to that special time, that special moment. Everybody's got a song that reminds them of some wonderful time in their life. But when I wrote I Can't Help It with Steve, we didn't know that Michael was going to perform it. The reason that Michael performed it, because it was written for songs in the key of life, which I only found out when I was at Spike Lee's journey from Motown to Off the Wall, which was his tribute to Michael Jackson. Yeah. That's when I found that out. And his sister actually jostled him into giving that song to Michael because she said it's perfect for him. And there's the key right there, because Stevie could have recorded it and could have said, well, yeah, but I want to do it, you know, because it's hard. It's hard when you write a song and you know it's magic to not do it yourself. But that's part of the talent. You have to know how that song fits into the culture and whether or not someone else can do a better job than you. That's maturity, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, I've written a lot of songs. Like Free, we rehearsed 6 days a week, and we were in the rehearsal studio when Nate Watts went up on the stage, was the bass player with Stevie. Mm-hmm. And he started playing the bass line.
Okay.
And it was much more of a Brazilian feel at that time. And then the other guys joined in and they were getting a little groove going. And Hank Red started playing a part. Hank was a saxophonist and the band leader. And Nisi just jumped on up there because that's how we did. If they were playing something, you go, oh, I know something that could go with that. It was very free flowing.
Kind of a jam
session. Went up on stage and started singing. Exactly. She started singing, whispering in his ear, my magic potion for love. I can hear her.
Yes.
And then all she had literally was, because I just got to be free. That part. She had the hook. Right. She says that I walked up there, I started writing. And I walked up there to her and handed her a piece of paper and said, sing this. I don't remember doing that. That sounds much too bold.
But I think that's what she said. To you.
Just a little bit. Just a little bit. I won't say that I'm bold, but I would say that sometimes you got to do what you got to do. You know,
boldness.
It's as simple as that.
Boldness.
Yeah.
But let me say this, because you are leaving out some of your accolades and the details. You didn't mention that Free was Denise Williams' first million seller that you wrote.
That's right.
And also, you did mention that you wrote songs for Will Downing and Seal and Lil' Kim and Fabulous and Ruben Studdard and so many other artists. I mean, so you're leaving out details in this history lesson on the music industry. I got to highlight it. That's my job.
Yes. Thank you. You know, I'm a humble person. I am. I'm very humble. And it's hard. I know from being in Clubhouse, you know, I hear people say more and more, you know, it's hard as an artist to talk about yourself. It's difficult to, you know, tell your story. But the thing is, you know, I was frozen with fear and shyness at one point. Yeah. And yet at a certain point, you think no one knows me any better than I do. And if I am going to get somewhere, I've got to tell my story until I can make the kind of money to get someone else to tell my story. Mm-hmm. And that was the key. You know, that was the key for me. But I've been blessed with songs, songwriting, and I never, I guess I don't emotionally take credit for it. I said, well, Jesus is writing.
Yes, you know? Oh, God.
And I believe that. Yeah, it's out there. You know, a song, a certain song, if you write, can take months. And you go back over it and rewrite and go back. But Free just came out. You know, and when it just comes out like that, you know, you feel it. It's like the hairs raise up on your arms. You get it, an excitement that you don't get ordinarily. But I've been blessed with songs, and blessed to the extent that, as well as musicians, one of my great, great gratefulnesses in life is how many wonderful musicians I have always met. Because musicians are a special breed, you know. They live a life of commitment to music, and that in itself is rather noble. Because so many musicians are underpaid, underacknowledged, you know, all of that. But I've been blessed to have the choice to sit at home, raise my children, my grandchildren, you know. It's a huge blessing. And in a time like this, in this crazy pandemic, when none of us were expecting this to happen, you know, it just stopped the world. That's why I know it's important. It's for something special.
Yeah.
It brings me to the point, because I am an artist at heart, you know. I am compelled to create. And that compulsion is something that you can't deny. You know, right. It's like you miss it. You miss it when you don't do it. And the painting, it's has always been that way for me. Music is one part. And now, because of the marriage between technology and art, everybody, they have the chance to make their art, particularly digital art, available to the world in a different way that's credible, more so than anything in history. This is a revolution and a renaissance. Mm-hmm. And I'm so glad to be alive. I'm so glad to be alive during this.
Can I just speak briefly to your genius and that which God has given you? I know that it's bigger than you. I know that the anointing has made the difference in your life and in your career. But you have not just written songs. You keep saying, I wrote songs. No, you wrote chart busters. So God allowed you to soar. You know, I believe when you have faith, even the size of a mustard seed, that's all God needs to know that you believe and you trust that he's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above anything you could think or ask. And I also wanted to speak to your humility, you know, for the people who are going to watch the playback and who are watching this interview. We met on Clubhouse. And so that's the miracle of life, because I've been blessed to meet and work with hundreds and hundreds of people. Yes. But one day we were sharing a stage. We were both moderators. Sure. And well, you weren't a moderator yet. You were right under me. So you slipped into the room, but you were on stage. And they said, introduce yourself. And you said in the softest voice, I was the last member of the Supremes. And I write songs. And I was like, wait, what did she say? As soon as I came up, I was like, I immediately messaged you. And I was like, I prayed. I said, God, let her get this message. Let her check, because we're not even friends yet. You said it so soft. Yeah. You said it so soft, like you work at Ralph's or CVS. And I'm like, what did she say?
But come on.
What did she say?
What are you gonna say? You know? Oh, thank you. It's my pleasure. Believe me.
I'm so honored.
It's a great pleasure.
I felt like, I felt like I had known you forever when we talked the other night for hours. And I enjoyed it. We laughed, we talked, we giggled. And so it's just, I think this pandemic has been a blessing for creatives and those who open up their heart, because I was right where you are. I did not want any part of this technology piece. I'm like, what are we going to do with this? And why can't I go out? So, but it has opened up blessings. Yes, it's opened up blessings like this, sitting and speaking with you one-on-one and relationships, building new relationships in the most blessed ways. And so as we start to round up the interview, tell me what's next. You started to allude to NFTs, and you're also the president of Dollhouse Records. And so what's next for Susaye Greene?
Dollface Records. But you know, the thing about living, seriously, about living. I was thinking the other day, and I haven't talked much about Ray, but Ray Charles was a tremendous influence in my life, probably the most influential person other than my mother and my father, you know, because he taught me about the commitment, you know, to standing backstage and going on out there and doing you, being you, and as fiercely as possible, you know, and putting your all into it, putting your whole heart into it, every time, because the people have paid their money and they're coming to be entertained, and you owe that to them, you know. But as a songwriter or an entertainer or an artist or whatever, I'm just a girl who's had tremendous opportunities. I'm a human being, but I'm also conscious. I'm desperately conscious of the blessings that I have had, you know? I know that I've lived a blessed life. I also know I'm still here. Oh! Amen. I like that part. I'm still here. And I can still sing, you know? I still have my full faculty of talent. I can still paint. And I love to learn. And that is what has led me forward, you know. Clubhouse is the darndest thing I've ever seen. There is no other place that I know of on earth where people can reach the people who can help them do what they need to do, who are the ones who make the decisions.
Yeah.
Where can you do that? You know, I moved to England because I was greatly disappointed in Hollywood and Hollywood's closed doors, you know? But God took me right on over there, hooked me up with Courtney Pine, made jazz famous to young people again and accessible to young people with Children of the Ghetto and his Journey to the Urge Within album. Once again, the right place. It's kind of like, it's kind of like Jonah, okay? God told Jonah to go to Nineveh.
Yes.
And John was like, no, but no, please don't make me go to Nineveh. So he did everything in his effort to not go there. He got on a boat going in the opposite direction and then fell overboard in a storm, swallowed by a whale who took him where? Nineveh. And that's God. And that's how God has been in my life.
Yes.
It's like, girl, you're going to Nineveh.
Exactly.
You know,
you can run, but you can't hide.
That's it. It's exactly right. And I don't want to hide or run anymore. You know, it's the most exciting creative time that I can remember in my life right now. Digital art has been legitimized, actually. And the onset of NFTs is going to change the world. It's not just about art, you know.
Right.
There are so many other uses. And luckily, my romance with the science world, because of the Raw Science Film Festival and the Google Lunar X Prize, which I was an advisor for Team Plan B Canada, to send a rover to the moon, privately funded. Because of that, I began judging the Raw Science Film Festival, which is a collection every year founded by my friend Carrie Kural that exposes the world to films that are science related. I'm a STEAM advocate. Science, technology, engineering, art, and mathematics.
Yes.
Children gotta have them because of the disciplines and because of the, it gives them critical thinking. But because of my association with the science community, I was able to meet Anita Vadavatha, who is a dear friend of mine, who's a tech genius, who lives in Silicon Valley and works on all kinds of marvelous things, is a long-range futurist. Mm-hmm. And she has really opened my mind. She and I have founded a show called Capital Code that's going to come out pretty soon. But Capital Code is about the machinery of capital. When you hear the word capital, you think money, finances.
Yes.
But it's about so much more. Mm-hmm. It's about influence and about culture. And even capital cities. But the wonderful thing about it is how these things, even politics and digital culture and social culture, social capital, these things come about because of influence. They turn into money eventually. And it's marvelous the way it has progressed. But now, because of technology and the marriage of technology to art. Hey, the possibilities are endless. We're making robots!
Indeed.
As well as so many other things. My art, I've just spoken today, had the best invitation to sit down and speak to one of these tremendous 3D digital studios who make everything move, Oculus and yes. The art itself, you know, to turn the art from 2D into 3D is a process that I'm just beginning with. But the animation, and once again, Supreme Extreme, who is my character. Supreme Extreme is a character who came into my head while I was asleep, and she had stolen my 25-year-old body, which I'm not using anymore. But she could do everything, right? Just everything. And it made me think about a lot of things. You know, I love the idea of people being on other planets and of us going. I'd love to go. I don't know that I will get a chance to. But every single entrepreneur that I know is talking about living off world. Now, that's pretty exciting. Yeah. These are the times we're living in, you know. So I'm well stuck into that world. And I'm looking forward to doing some tremendous things. We have so many things lined up that I never thought I would be able to do. But because technology has caught up with art, while I'm alive, I am so grateful.
It is a blessing, and it sounds amazing. And you know, I was an engineer before I became an entertainment exec. So my heart is with science, technology, engineering, the arts, because that's where I ended up, and mathematics. And so,
of course.
Let me know if there's anything you need, where I can be a part of what you're moving forward into. Is there
Absolutely.
Any closing remarks that you have?
Absolutely.
Closing remarks?
Just that. Yes. Just that we know we are in these extraordinary times, and mm-hmm. that means it's time for us to do extraordinary things. It is our mm-hmm. duty as creative people to reach further, to dig deeper, to do the things that we thought impossible and make them possible. And anybody who needs some help getting there, reach out to me. I'm on Twitter, Susaye Greene. That's SusayeGreene. And I will answer you and help if I can. And if I don't know how to do something, I know somebody who does.
Exactly.
That's what's lovely about life.
Thank you so much. This was such a blessing, such an amazing conversation. I know it's going to bless many, many people as I continue to repost it and share the wisdom that you shared about the music industry and now your involvement with science and technology and engineering, the arts and mathematics, and integrating it all as part of STEAM programs and moving forward young people in various capacities. Yes. I think that's absolutely beautiful, and we share that synergy.
Thank you.
And,
thank you.
And that's important. I think it's so important to inspire as many young people as we can. So I thank you so much, Susaye. And I'm going to close out the show. I'm going to meet you backstage in just a second. But thank you so much. I'm so honored to have you.
Thank you for having me. I just enjoy you so much. You know, I know that we are friends. I know that. I know that we met to be friends. So I'm just so happy to meet you.
Because I felt like I knew you forever. It just felt like, it didn't feel like an intro conversation. We finally got on the phone. And I was like, we just talked and talked and talked. And so much and energy. I feel like spiritually I'm a cross between your mother and you in terms of how I hit things and how I go for things. But
bravo. Bravo.
I mean, that's greatness in and of itself. But I will meet you in just a couple of seconds backstage. Thank you again so much. And this concludes the 20th episode of Just One Thing, the show about life-changing, life-defining moments. And we had an amazing interview with the beautiful Susaye Greene, one formerly of the Supremes and last artist Supreme signed to Motown. Her story about working with Stevie Wonder. She's a hit maker, not just songwriter, but a hit maker, and the Ray Lutz. And so if you missed this interview, go back and watch it. I'm Charmel McMillan, and join me tomorrow night at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time here again for another episode of Just One Thing. I have musician Donnie Bowie, and he had developed cancer at 3 years old. It took his sight, but find out what he's doing now as an adult and as a dynamic musician. That's another episode you don't want to miss. I'm Charmel McMillan. Thank you for joining me, and I'll see you tomorrow night.